one more typical of genuine American enterprise, courage and instinct for success.
The great showman's humble birthplace is in Bethel, Connecticut, where he was born in 1810.
Ladies and gentlemen, this home all dates from 1835, Mr. Barnum presented his first attraction, Joy's Head, the oldest from the line. Mr. Barnum presented her in New York City, Boston, and Philadelphia.
Here is Mr. Barnum's famed American Museum in New York City, in which she opened in 1842. The American Museum was one of the largest, best amusement institutions and held 600,000 exhibitions, including
Educated Fleas,
A Tribe of Aborigines,
Anne Swan, the world's tallest woman,
Ching Ching, the pathetic Siamese twins,
Grizzly Ann's in Spain, California, Animal Menagerie,
Niagara Falls with real water,
Living Statuary,
Indian water dances,
Live Gorillas,
everyone and all of mankind.
On July 30, 1865, due to a gas leak, Barnum's American Museum burned to the ground, destroying 600,000 exhibitions.
None of Mr. Barnum's attractions were more famous than Tom Thumb, the smallest man in the world, just 25 inches in total crown. Tom Thumb made his debut on 78, 1842 in Philadelphia.
Tom Thumb went to England and performed before Queen Victoria, but the 82 million tickets sold for P.D. Barnum's attractions, 20 million were sold for Tom Thumb alone.
In 1873, Tom Thumb hired Lavinia Warren Bunn, the lady just a few inches shorter than he was. Half the house was regular size for seeing visitors, and half was scaled down for the comfort of Mr. and Mrs. Thumb.
In September 1850, Barnum engaged Jenny Lind, Swedish Nightingale. This is her portrait. 8 months earlier, no one in America had known who she was. With Barnum's general parting, 30,000 were on hand to meet her ship. Jenny Lind's first concert was in New York, and for each concert she was paid $1,000.
Here is Jumbo, brought to America by Mr. Barnum from the Royal Geological Society of London. Jumbo measured 12 feet in shoulder and weighed 6 1/2 tons. With his 7 foot trunk, he was capable of reaching an object 26 feet from the ground. His diet included 200 pounds of hay and a quart of bourbon whiskey each day.
Mr. Barnum retired from the menagerie and business life for several years, political and business life, returning to entertainment in 1880 when he joined forces with Mr. James Bailey to create the Great Show Honor.
Thank you. that tonight, on this stage, you are going to witness Barnum every sight, wonder, and miracle that that name stands for, including Jumbo, the largest elephant in the world, the great white whale from Labrador, General Tom Thumb, only 25 inches high, tall a crown, Joyce Heck, the oldest woman in the world, the rarest and most beautiful bird in captivity, the Swedish nightingale, and a cast of hundreds, no, thousands, including marching bands, standing bands, tumbling bands, flying bands, bands of every size, shape, and description. And here they are. Oh, I know what you're thinking. You don't see any flying bands or 25-inch men or Swedish nightingale. But like I said, Barnum's my name and Humbug's my game, and they're all up there, mark my word. Where are you going? But I got a point of view to expound, defending the noble art of Humbug.
Which I happen to be in disagreement with, because it's no more than a shunning offensive limb, so it doesn't behoove me to stick around.
Respect for the speaker, madam, requires you to listen while he sets forth his convictions.
And respect for my own convictions requires me to set forth, which I'm doing.
Then go. Isolated dissent is hardly going to deter me. One small voice can quite easily be ignored.
Good day, Mr. Barnum.
Of course, it doesn't help that one small voice belongs to his wife. Cherry Barnum, I'll have a kiss before you leave.
With pleasure, Mr. Barnum. It may not make much sense, but you're beautiful.
In the memory, ladies and gentlemen, the fight to the finish struggle of Humbug versus Truth, Flip Flam versus Fact, Mr. Phineas Taylor Barnum versus his good wife, Cherry. In an American pageant featuring stirring music.
Oh,
what comes of marrying a schoolteacher. They go right to the books. Carry on talking about rosy possibilities. The kind of humbug those bunch of pilgrims sold themselves when they set sail on the Mayflower. The dream, Charlie.
Mr. Webcast is not sitting in the tomb, Taylor. Lies. Now don't give up. The evening's young, and you still have some goals and possibilities.
Thank you. okay, maybe I misled him a bit. But those folks went home thinking that they shook the hand that held the rosy bottom of the farthest country. And that's a patriotic humbug, and there's none better. Now that Joyce was a success, I started signing up other attractions, but I needed some place to put them.
There's your app, Mr. Barnum. I'm the poor portraiture on the American Museum, but I don't. Mr. Barnum? Mr. Barnum. That's right. I'm looking for a portraiture on the American Museum, but I don't want to turn into no sideshow.
I couldn't agree with you more. That's why I'm tangling all five floors with the most educational humbugs imaginable. Including three galleries of art, a lecture theatre holding 5,000 people, and in the rotunda glass pen, holding a living, breathing, spouting great white whale from Labrador. And just to help you make up your mind, I present you with this ticket, entitling you and a friend to two free admissions upon paying your one half the regular price any Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday between the hour of 12 noon and 1 p.m. Is it a deal?
Hey, Paul, did you or did you not have an appointment to take me to lunch at 4 o'clock sharp? It's now past 2:14.
Taken
them for more than money, Taylor. You get them all bought up. things that can never be. Like a woman 160 years old. Now, I don't mind you using the imagination, good Lord Gaver, but with $2 to bring up, you should be using it for more sensible things. Now, I happen to know Mr. John C. Jerome's looking for a partner at the clockwork factory. I could be part of it. Keep the accounts. Write the letters.
Cherry, I just can't do it. Tick, tock, tick from 10 to 6. With the occasional bomb to break up the monotony of 10,000 cuckoos looking out of 10,000 little holes. Every man's got a temperament, Mrs. Barnum. Mine's just not suited to tick, tock, cuckoo, and bomb!
I'm sorry, Taylor. I shouldn't have
cut it up. Of course you should. That's half a wife's job, bringing up things a husband doesn't want to hear. Just say the name Grace Hot Clockworks, and what do you see? Grey and brown, and perhaps, if you're lucky, a little dash of tall. Walk inside in the sideshow, and you got Fire Engine Red, and Buttercup Yellow, and Kelly Green, and it's like living inside a giant pinwheel. And it's not just for my own selfish pleasure I want to wear colours. I want to splash them out for everyone in this world to see.
Thank you.
printed over the back door. To the egress!
To the egress?
Don't get frightened, it's just a fancy word for exit.
But Mr. Barnum, no one knows what it means.
They will when they get outside. That's the health and education humbug. They learn a new word and get some fresh air.
What's right for you is wrong for me. Together we're a
I'll change my dress. But it's not to show off these pearls to your New York friends. Because I'm still in love with you, fool. And I want one of your damn marital homeworks to succeed.
Jerry! How can you say that? I've never tried to humbug you!
Mr. Barnum?
Darling Mr. Scudder, can't you see I'm lying to my wife?
But Mr. Barnum!
Mr. Scudder, what the devil brings you out here at this time of night, anyhow?
A fire!
Speak up, Mr. Scudder!
A fire at the museum! It's no use going down there. There's nothing left. I'm sorry.
I hope I'm being humbugged.
Elias, Mr. Barnum, you never talk again.
Mr. Scudder! Celebrating a museum what's burned down. You're right. Darn place is nothing but a sideshow anyhow.
Tell you, Barnum, how can you say that? That museum was absolutely splendid for what it was, and I won't listen to anything to the contrary. Why? New York's not the only place to be living, you know. There's a whole country out there, and right here in Bridgeport, you...
Darling Jeff, you haven't come up with a solution. There is an entire country out there. And there's me, pinning my life away on the corner of Air Street and Broadway, when there must be 24 states never even heard of the name P.T. Barnum. I rebuilt the entire museum and put wheels on it.
Taylor Barnum, I wasn't thinking of any 24 states.
We'll start with a 3-month swing around the East. All I need is a headline attraction and some capital. And since it was your idea...
What?
And since it was your idea, we'll have a top line on every ad that says, entire tour under the personal supervision of Mr. and Mrs. P.T. Barnum. You are with me on this, Cherry, aren't you? Cherry?
Well, Taylor, I'm not sure I'm 100% in accord.
Then everything's all right. We're quarreling again.
And now, a delicious week's roll, library!
small, as in sum of money. Now, exactly what do you mean when you refer to others?
Now, surely, Mr. Barnum, any boy of only 25 inches from head to toe is a freak of nature.
Hold on, Mr. Stratton. Joyce Heth is 160 years old. Madam Josepha has a 10-inch beard.
Mr. Barnum.
And Swan is 8.5 feet tall. That doesn't make them freaks. It makes them special.
Mr. Barnum.
What you call it, aberration of nature, I call it a gift from God to rise above the ground. And since he's old enough to speak for himself, why don't we ask the boy? Now, Charlie, I want you to come with me and join my show. But I'm not going to fool you. Tens, hundreds, maybe thousands of people are going to come to see you. Some to stare, maybe even a few to laugh. But most will come and tell their children and grandchildren for years to come that they saw the smallest man in the world. We'll even find your name to go with the miracle of your size. Thumb, Tom Thumb. And not forgetting the princely salary to you and your dear parents of $15 a week. Now, I'll put it as fairly as I can. What do you say? Is it a deal? What did I say that boy's name was? Thumb. Tom Thumb. Sounds a bit skimpy to me. What we need is a handle. Sir Thomas Thumb. No, was justice. I took all those years most women take off their own and added it to hers.
But be that as it may, Mr. Barnum, but if we have to be in the exhibition business, you can at least find yourself one respectable attraction.
Mr. Barnum, all my congratulations. Julius Goldschmidt, we met last autumn in New York, and I caught your show here in Boston last night. Absolutely splendid.
That's very kind, Mr. Goldschmidt. Cherry, you remember Mr. Julius Goldschmidt? He's the gentleman who introduced Mr. Boone on his last tour.
Of course. What brings you to Boston, Mr. Goldschmidt?
Boston's home to me, Mrs. Barnum. I just stopped off for a little visit. I was sailing out to England to sign up for that Swedish girl who's made such a stir over there.
Jenny Lind, I read about her. Two command performances for the Queen.
Lind?
Yes,
Lind! The Indian rubber lady who can tie a knot in her right arm.
Jenny Lind's an opera singer, Mr. Barnum, and according to all the critics, her voice is the most glorious sound ever heard. But you'll get a chance to see for yourself when I present her first concert next fall to Castle Garden. Better get going. That New York train's doing a quarter of an hour. Mr. Barnum, it's been a great day.
Goldsmith's a nice fellow, but I wouldn't like to see him lose his shirt.
You don't think he'll be able to sign up his lip?
No, that's just it. I think he will. And I can't see the American public filling an entire hall just to see an opera singer.
I'm not so sure you're right, Taylor. You heard what the man said. Two command performances. It's high time you found yourself an attraction like that.
Oh, don't start that again, or we'll miss the Chicago train. Anyway, I wouldn't know where to begin.
It's very simple. We toss a coin. Tails, we continue as we are. Heads, I continue to run the rest of the tour while you go to England to make a deal with Miss Smith's agents.
But what would I say to him?
That you were afraid New York wouldn't buy an opera singer and you didn't want to see him lose his shirt.
But I call that lies, Jerry.
I call it trimming, Miss Taylor.
Mrs. Barnum, this is uncharted territory.
I'm equal to it, Taylor, and so are you.
I could have missed the train and followed Charlie West, but I didn't. I made the train, I made the vault, and I made the deal. Now I had only one thing to work out. Who the hell was Jenny Lind? But like that fella Shakespeare once said, what's in a name anyhow? It's titles the public wants. We'll call her the scintillating Swede from Scandinavia. No. The songbird who scintillates from Sweden. No. I got it! The singing Swede. It was too late anyhow. Charlie had the handbill bills printed up, and we were stuck with calling up the Swedish Nightingale. Can't win them all.
Sensational play.
you eat.
Ladies.
Ladies.
Ladies and.
Boys.
And. And gentlemen.
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 Gentlemen. No! Gentlemen. Oh, that'll have to do. And any other words will charge off to European style. Now, don't forget a smile. If there's one thing no American can resist, it's the smile of a beautiful lady. No American man, anyhow. Now, the show's about to start, so I'll be getting out of the hall.
be a problem. Damn receipts, they've got to be counted again. Bookkeeper messed it all up. So you take the carriage and I'll be right along.
Taylor, this bookkeeping couldn't wait until tomorrow.
No, it can't.
Very well then. I'll see you when I see you. It was a great success this evening and I'm very proud of you. Good night, Naomi. Good night, Miss Ed.
Cherry! Miss Lynn, I... Well, damn it, why shouldn't I take the reception? Hell, it's only for an hour. All my life I've been selling the dreams to everyone else. Why shouldn't I get a look at it myself?
Thank you.
parasite, that sweeter than that. Damn it, Brooke, don't I get one evening off?
Miss Flint asked me to remind you that the reception's at 7 o'clock sharp. And since President Flint wants to stick with punctuality.
Whole 6 months of this tour's been nothing but tea with the President, reception of the Chief Justice, and supper with the Senator. When do they get time to run the country? So help me, Brooke, now give up this entire tour just to get away from them.
You don't mean that, Mr. Barnum.
Oh, I do. Goldsmith's been hankering after me for her contract, and I have a good mind to sell it to him. It was all right at the beginning when we were trying to turn a Swedish nightingale into an opera singer. But now all that bird is good for his money, and it's not enough. Oh, it's my own damn fault. I humbugged myself into thinking I needed some more colour in my life. And she humbugged me into being respectable. Miserable state of affairs as far as I'm concerned. And I prefer to be miserable and respectable with someone I love.
But I thought you, Miss Lind.
So did I, but I was wrong. It's going to be a waste of time, I know it. None of my female of the species humbugs seem to pan out, but I'm too old a dog not to try. Now, Goldsmith, Milton, send a wire to Goldsmith, telling him I'll meet him in New York City the day after tomorrow, and another to Mrs. Barnum, saying if that coin comes up heads again, I might very well be in Bridgeport at the end of next week. Never heard of such carryings on. And in public. Damn disgrace, if you ask me.
Phineas, are you muttering?
Me? I never mutter. I think it's the height of impoliteness.
Then are you just ignorant?
I never mutter. I might utter, but I never mutter. I used to have a mutter. If I've got anything to say that matters, I utter. I don't mutter. It's still a damn disgrace.
I wish I knew what this is all about. The way Master smiled at
me
last night.
What do I care? Some weedy looking Frenchie smiles at you. It's the way you smile at him. One of your special number two trembling ones.
Phineas, I was a prawn. And we flirt. And where impresarios matter. Anyway, what's sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander.
What are you talking about?
Letters.
What letters?
Long ones. Daily. A lady in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Now, if you're willing to give up these letters, I might be willing to give up my trembling smiles.
Jenny, I want you to know that I'll never forget you.
It's been a lovely 6 months. Should I live the tomorrow on the years? In English, I want for you what you want for yourself.
That's a very kind wish, Jenny. Now I have to figure out what it is the devil it is I do want.
Well, at least you know what it is. When do you think of leaving?
Tonight seems a good time as any. Will you be all right?
I think so. I have a dinner engagement with your friend Jim Master.
Thank you.
want to release me from my promise.
Go right ahead, Taylor.
Never once.
after London, with her standing there beside me, right when we were on the threshold. Now, I don't want you boys to worry, because during this campaign, I'm going to be stronger than ever. I've been working a long time for the senatorial nomination, and it's an election I don't plan to lose.
I'm afraid there's been a slight postponement in our nomination.
What are you talking about? What are you talking about? I've been barnstorming for the past 6 months on the strength that I'd have your nomination.
But it seems out of your hands, Mr. Barnum. In 4 years, you've been prime candidate.
I don't want the nomination in 4 years. I promised someone very special I'd be there next January. And if I'm not there then, I don't want to be there at all. Good day.
But Mr. Barnum.
Get out! They took me, Jerry. 6 months of making speeches, and they take away the nomination with a humbug worse than I've ever pulled in 35 years of fooling people. I thought I'd got it out of my system, but I was wrong. Because if I don't humbug them, they're going to do worse to me. And tell me, Jerry, is humbug so bad after all? Look at those Rubens that came over on the Mayflower. They humbugged themselves into finding some kind of utopia, and it turned out pretty good. And Tom Jefferson and Ben Franklin, back in 76, humbugged themselves with a vision of creating a whole society of free and equal people, and theirs were strong enough to win a war. Of course, I'm not comparing live mermaids and four-headed frogs to the Declaration of Independence. But somehow, deep down, there's a connection. How'd you like that? 2 minutes up here on the soapbox, and I've convinced myself that I'm first cousins with Thomas Jefferson. Well, darn it, Charlie, don't that prove it? At humbugging, I'm the best there is. Oh, don't worry, Charlie. I'm not thinking of going back into the menagerie business. I thought of a lecture tour. Tell the whole country about the noble art of humbug. And who better to tell them than me? After all, it's the thing God gave me the gift for. And it's how I got everything I ever had. Even you, Charlie, even you!
In a world of sting and shock, this moment we spent down.
Need to hook you attractive to the mood of the country. It's 1880, and
And with Grant in the White House, we're looking to expand our boundaries. Your show looks good, but it's too small. You need 10 elephants and 20 clowns, plus bareback riders, fat ladies, a whole family of jugglers, six up on the high wire.
Impossible. How'd you get all the facts in just one ring?
Put two rings on either side, and a 24-piece band, and a separate tent just for sideshow, and a grandstand that you can take up and bring down that seats 5,000 people, and a special train with two locomotives and 60 carriages, and enough canvas to fill the entire Crystal Palace, and still have room to fly a kite.
The Crystal Palace. Mr. Barr, I hope I'm not being humble.
Whatever gave you that idea?
Well, the way you tell it, it does sound pretty good. But you gotta help me.
Out of the question!
But I need you. The circus needs you.
No!
Thank you.
by Italy, this amazing human cannonball. And now, the king of the jungle, Anton Fyodorovich and his Royal African Lions. And now, ladies and gentlemen, up on the high wire, those internationally celebrated sisters, Lily and Lisa. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the greatest show on earth is proud to present in the center ring, Barnum and Bailey's Elephant Parade.
Baloney.